We're back with Christopher Layton, Barbara LaChance, and we're having the most stimulating conversation regarding the face of revival. So let's continue talking about, you had just mentioned a few seconds ago about the importance of prayer and about the fact that we need to provide a foundation of intercession if revival is going to be more than just a flash in the pan.
Right.
And you were talking about the fact that revival historically has been so much longer lasting.
We've been working too hard. Mm-hmm. We've been working too hard, praying too hard for it to be a flash in the pan. I don't want to be part of a flash in the pan. So what sustains it and keeps it going? And that's what we're really talking about here.
I think because our visions are too small.
Right?
You know, sometimes we just think that you know, all God wants is just the church to be revived.
A lot of times the enemy comes in and is able to disrupt or even quench a move of God, God forbid, but it does happen at times. You know, I think a lot of these are aborted. They're meant to thrive and go on for many, many years. And so what I say to young people when they come to me, these are young leaders that want to be pastors, and first thing I tell them is if you can do anything else, don't become a pastor. If you can do anything else with any peace, don't become a pastor. And then if
you have a virtue for saying controversial things that have a lot of depth. But I love it. So continue. I think you're right. You're right. I sometimes have the same impulse.
Then the last thing
you want to do is become
what's a
pastor.
Stay where
you
are. What's a leader in the church? You know, that this one's really controversial. Maybe the leader is the person who would fall away from their faith if it were possible for someone to fall away from their faith. But they're called by God to lead worship, to be in the Word, because they wouldn't be able to sustain their faith unless they had a job and they had to do this every day of their life. That's pretty.
And also, I mean, not only
that,
but you know, how are they going to influence people if they're not in the world? You've been talking, Barbara, about the fact that you know more people sometimes outside of the church than in the church. Mm-hmm. And you know what's been said, I mean, statistics that Christians after 5 years, they sort of lose all their contacts with the outside world. They just go deep into the Christian culture, and we stop being salt. Tell me a little bit about your own experience regarding moving in the world, influencing, and the fact that we need to have Christians getting out there and being in those places of influence in order to actually do what God wants them to do.
Well, just as an example, we formed a nonprofit organization called Tipping a Nation to do some work in Africa.
Tipping a Nation.
To do some work in Africa. Mm-hmm. And one of the women who's on our board is a Hindu. And I specifically wanted to have a board that wasn't made up of all Christians, even though what we're doing, everything we're doing is biblically based. And we make no qualms about that. You know, what our product is all biblically based, and we're going in to train emerging leaders. And so anyway, this woman, you know, has become like my best friend. My husband's going to start doing business with her. And so what we want to do is we just want to build a relationship with people, have an ongoing trust and build trust, and hopefully at some point my heart is always to lead people to Christ. And I do this with all the relationships that I have in coaching. When I coach people and I go through the wheel of life with them and spirituality is part of that, I had one woman, I said, where do you want to be spiritually? And a 1 or a 10. And she said, I want to be a 10. I said, oh, all right, let me take off my coach's hat. Can I put on my minister's cap? She said, sure. I led her to Christ. You know, so if we can use the giftings that we have and then use it to glorify God and bring him to Christ. If I have inside of me is intentional evangelism, outside it comes across as I really want to be your friend. I love these people. I love the women in my business networking group, and I have great times with them. And I want to continue those relationships. If I'm spending all my time in church, what good am I doing?
No, just saying it's a version of what we had been speaking about earlier with art, where you have to trust the spirit that is implicit in what you do. And you have to take a much broader view of your medium. In evangelism, it's the same way. I think what a lot of Christians are beginning to discover is that this idea of you know, getting the four spiritual laws in people's faces immediately as soon as you meet them. And you know, it's not necessarily the best approach for this time in God's move. And that sometimes you need to just take a longer approach where you let God in you, Christ in you, touch that individual, and you trust the Holy Spirit to provide the proper opportunity. And also, I think a lot of evangelism today should be about breaking down stereotypes. There's this idea of Christians being narrow-minded and, you know, object-oriented, and you know, it needs to be more.
If going out with the four spiritual laws and getting in people's faces and say, you need to be saved, read this and pray this prayer worked, then the church would be a much bigger place. Yeah. We'd have a lot more people
and, you know,
there.
It's had its role.
It has,
but it has
absolutely.
To be more than that.
And I don't
there's
mind
a time and a place for sharing the spiritual laws, but not first
exactly.
hand.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But I went out to lunch the other day with this woman, and she read my book, and she the whole time during lunch I talked about God. She sent me an email and thanked me for going to lunch with her, and she says, "You have such deep conviction in your faith about God. Thank you that you feel comfortable sharing that with me, but you didn't force it on me." And you know, but it keeps planting seeds, plant seeds, and then God's going to come along. God's going to water the seeds.
If I could circle back to what we were talking about with leaders, I don't just try to dismiss
them. Well, I was asking also about youth. You had begun saying that.
Right.
I think
and these young people come to me,
those two things.
And they want to be a pastor. They want to be a leader in this move of God. And what should they do? And I think the first thing that a minister or a pastor gives to his people or her people is their personal holiness. And your personal holiness is your walk with God, what you hear God saying to you, how you are growing in your relationship with God. You can't give to somebody else what you don't have.
The passion, the vitality, the commitment, the intimacy.
And some of these young people are going to have some personal successes before they can have public successes. You can't put a new Christian in a place of responsibility, the Bible tells us, because the temptations and the requirement of maturity is so great that they've got to, you know, they've got to kind of, you know, ride a bike before they drive a car. And this is true. This is a principle. So what can I do to enhance my holiness? And this is not like I'm a holy Joe. I mean, holiness is consecration. It's separateness. It makes me different. And it's because God is in me. The more God has of me, the more He might be coming through me and, you know, cut me, and maybe God will come out and not just blood or, you know. So, for instance, what I say to young people is you've got to get an accountability and support group. Mm-hmm. And you've got to meet with some people who will tell you the truth and be in a position to hear this and receive it. And they'll not only, like, you know, speak the truth in love, but they'll also help you get to where you need to be through prayer and through ministry, healing. A lot of ministers need inner healing, you know, and a lot of us are wounded. And there's a popular phrase, wounded healers, Henry Nouwen, and I love that book, The Wounded Healer. But I also think we need, yes, people who've been wounded who are now healed, because some of the problems have been the wounded healer did not get healed. And if you're not a healed person, you're hurting people.
Well, let's talk a little bit about that in the upcoming segment, because I think you're touching on a very important thing, which is, again, you know, God can move among His people in very powerful ways, but it does not take away the fact that we will continue being human beings with all our brokenness, our frailty, our need for continual renewal. And even as God begins to manifest Himself powerfully, I think what the culture is seeking is transparency, authenticity, honesty. And I think that needs to be also a distinctive of this coming revival. So let's pick up on that in a few seconds and continue our conversation.